Hello everyone, welcome to AI Show. Today's episode will be very interesting because we will be talking about quantum machine learning. Alex, please tell us who you are and what do you do?
Hello, I'm Alex Bocharov, a principal researcher with Microsoft Quantum Systems Group. I have been with the group pretty much since its early inception. And after working through some hard quantum compilation issues about 3 years ago, we turned to exploring the domain of quantum machine learning.
Interesting. And quantum computing is becoming this new buzzword. Everybody is super interested about it. So can you tell me or explain to me more why that is happening?
Well, in my opinion, the quantum computing is the most exciting agenda of the 21st century. Quantum computer is not a silver bullet. It's based on principles of quantum mechanics, which are very hard to harness. But it's very good at solving rather hard problems that are pretty much insolvable with the traditional computation technologies. To name just a few, that would be advances in material science, cryptography, physics simulation, and such.
Nice. And what about machine learning and AI?
So compared to the lifespan of the quantum computing industry, quantum machine learning has a shorter history. It starts just over a decade ago with a set of fundamental works where people figured out a way to quantize familiar setups in machine learning, such as support vector machines, classifiers, neural nets, and quantum recommenders. So all of this, at least in theory, is available and working.
All right, in theory. So when will we see quantum neural networks in practice?
Well, the original designs are based on so-called quantum linear algebra. Are only meant for very large, very well error-corrected quantum computers, which are not coming in for a decade or two. So in a shorter term, the community turned to a more practical technology based on things called variational quantum surrogates.
Okay.
And kind of related ideas to that.
Can you tell me more about the properties of those variational quantum circuits?
So variational quantum circuit is a smaller, one can view it as a program running on quantum computer, but it is a smaller one, and it's trainable. And being small, it does two things. First of all, it uses some of the quantum computing power, what the quantum computer does the best. But a hybrid training scheme makes use of a traditional traditional computing surrounding, which does all the bookkeeping, takes care of the pre-processing of data and post-processing of the results. And in tandem, they do a good job training those moderate size machine learning solutions.
Interesting. And is it pure theoretical at this point, or do you have practical solution?
So the quantum community put recently a lot of effort and hours into creating various open source proposals and offerings where the machine learning solutions based on quantum variational circuits are reduced to practice. This includes our most recent addition to our Q-sharp QDK world. What we offer now is an open source quantum machine learning library, which at this point offers just quantum classifiers. And so you can download it, play with it, and you could actually see how different is the quantum machine learning training and generalization from the traditional models.
Right. And Chris will demonstrate this to us in a few minutes. But before I let you go, can you please share your opinion? Where do you think it will all evolve? What are our next steps?
The main thrust should be, in my opinion, to be in scaling out the solutions that we have now, and which have been reduced to practice running on simulators so far. Mm-hmm. We need to make sure they run well on actual hardware, and more importantly, they scale out well. Mm-hmm. Meaning we have some certainty that the power and the precision of those quantum machine learning solutions grow in a lockstep with the growth of the quantum computers as they are becoming available and more powerful.
Got it. Well, thank you very much, Alex. That was super interesting, and I hope to see you more in this show, telling us more interesting things about quantum machine learning. Thank you.
I will be looking forward to it as well, and thank you very much for having me.
Hi Chris, welcome to AI Show. Alex just gave us a really nice introduction into quantum machine learning. So now it's your turn to show us practical side of things. But before we do that, please tell us who you are and what do you do?
Yeah, and thank you for having me here. I'm Chris Granade, a research software development engineer on the quantum systems team here at Microsoft. And much of my day-to-day, I work with putting libraries out there, such as the Q-Sharp standard library, and also more domain or application-focused libraries, such as the machine learning library that I'll be talking about
nice.
More today.
All right, so let's jump in. How can we use quantum computing for machine learning applications?
So that's where the quantum development kit comes in. The QDK provides a new language, Q-Sharp, that you can use to write quantum programs to solve problems that you care about using the power of quantum.
I see. And what about the development environment? Do I need special, I don't know, quantum IDEs or something?
Well, so let me pop on over to Visual Studio Online so you can see what a Hello World program looks like in Q-Sharp. You could also use Visual Studio Code or Visual Studio as you prefer. But if I look at a Hello World program in Q-Sharp, the thing that really I'd like to point out here is it looks a lot like a Hello World program in any other language. It's just Hello World.
And I don't see any manipulations with the qubits. So can you show an example of that?
Yeah. So if I look at the quantum random number generator sample provided with the quantum development kit, one of the things that really helps me understand how this sample works is to think of Q-Sharp in the same way I might think of code that I run on a GPU or an FPGA as a kind of accelerator, right? Where I run a program here on a quantum device to solve problems that I care about on a quantum computer when that's the best tool to use. And I do that by sending instructions to that quantum device represented in Q-Sharp by built-in operations. So for instance, if I ask the machine for a qubit using a using statement, I can then send instructions to the device to go do things to that qubit, such as the H instruction, short for Hadamard, that lets me prepare some superposition, or M, short for measure, that measures back and gets classical data that I can use in the rest of that Q-Sharp program, or send out to the kinds of languages and tools that I might use in the rest of my workflow, such as Python or C-Sharp.
Very interesting. But does it mean that I will have to learn all of those quantum gates, all those operators to use quantum machine learning?
Thankfully, no. Q-Sharp is a high-level language so that you get things like the ability to pre-process your data and train classifiers using Q-Sharp library functions and operations to represent the high-level structure of the task that you're trying to run. So for instance, I can write out, you know, adding a product kernel to some features from some training data. I can write out the rest of my pre-processing, how I want to sample some training data to make mini batches, as well as what the structure of a quantum classifier that I want to train is. And once I have all that, I can then pass that to the Q-Sharp operation to train a classifier that's provided with the Q-Sharp quantum machine learning library. And when I do that, I get to control how that training proceeds by passing various options, some of which are probably fairly familiar to a traditional machine learning workflow, such as the learning rate or the mini batch size. Others, such as the number of measurements, reflects that my goal here really is to send the right instructions to that quantum device to prepare a superposition that represents the data that I'm trying to train, trying to classify during training.
Since we are talking about data set itself, maybe you can share a little bit more what the problem we're trying to solve. So tell us about the trained data and the data set itself.
Absolutely. So the sample that you just saw trains a classifier to label a half moon data set. Here, that's a synthetic data set that's a little bit difficult to break into classes, so that we can use it to benchmark and understand how classifiers work and how they might be used for more real world or applied data. And what makes it hard is that those two moons kind of interlock at their ends, so that if I try to draw a straight line anywhere through that plot, I'm going to chop off one or the other, and I'm going to wind up misclassifying that way.
All right. I think we're ready just to look at the code running.
Awesome. Well, so let me pop on over to Jupyter Notebook so that I can call the sample that you just saw from Python. And that will let me use things built into Python, such as JSON functionality, to go load the training data that I want to use. And there you see all of the features broken down. That's just the X and Y coordinates from the plot you saw a moment ago. And then I can set some starting points for where I want to begin the training and pass all of that to the Q-sharp operations you saw in the sample before using the simulate method. And what happens when I call that is the quantum development kit will run that Q-sharp operation locally on my machine and simulate how it might work on a real quantum device. That way I can use a conventional computer to understand, test, and develop an algorithm and make sure that it works in the way that I want it to before running it on actual hardware. When I do that, I get the trained classifier back out, and I can then go do the same thing with a validation operation to understand that it has about a 13% miss rate, which is pretty good given that data set. I can also use standard Python tools like NumPy and Matplotlib to help me understand what the classifier actually did, where those misclassifications came from. And so when I plot that, you see that it missed 2 points, one of which was on the very tail of one of those moons, which, as we saw earlier, is where it gets the most difficult. And the other was where there is just enough noise to push one of those moons too close to the other, and so it's a very difficult point to classify. And that gives me the kind of understanding I need to improve my training procedure going forward as I look at more applied uses of quantum machine learning.
Well, this is very interesting, and I'm curious, like, if I want to play with it myself, is it available right now for download?
Absolutely. Everything you've seen here today is a part of the quantum development kit. You can check it out all open source on GitHub and use it today.
Perfect. All right. Well, Chris, thank you very much. But before I let you go, I want to ask your opinion or your vision. Where do you think it will go in next couple of months, year, a couple of years from now?
So that's a great question. The thing that really helps me to remember when I think of that, is how much of what you saw here today came out of the cutting-edge research taking place on the quantum systems team here at Microsoft. Everything from the classifier that you saw to the way that we trained that classifier are ideas that came out of research on the quantum systems team. As that research proceeds, we'll see new algorithms, new approaches, new applications, and we'll also see improvements to the existing applications, such as the training that you saw today. And that research will let us make the quantum machine learning library better and put more tools into your hands so that you can explore how quantum machine learning impacts things that you care about.
All right, Chris, thank you very much once again, and I hope to see you soon with more interesting news about quantum machine learning. Thank you.
I look forward to it. Thanks for having me.